I'm going to hand over firstly. Our first speaker is Dr. Haniel Bunner, who really doesn't need an introduction at all. He's been our teacher for decades, and especially those of us who come from Birmingham. My husband was very blessed to have spent many, many days in Dr. Hani Bunner's house learning from him. So those of you who don't know Dr. Hani, he's founder of Islamic Relief, chairman of the Muslim Charities Forum and Zakat House, president of the Humanitarian Forum. 2004 was a very busy year. His awards in 2004 were the OBE, the Ibn Khaldun Award, promoting understanding between global cultures and faiths, and the Egyptian Medical Syndicate Award. In 2005, he received the Kashmiri and Pakistani Professional Association Award. 2007, the UK Muslim Power 100 awarded him with their Lifetime Achievement Award. And then he was awarded the Ubuntu Award for Social Responsibility from the Department of International Relations and Cooperation of South Africa. So without further ado, I'm going to hand over to Dr. Haniel Bunner on the topic Ramadan Without the Mosque, how to connect to our mission this Ramadan.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ramadan without the mosque. I think what we need to look at ourselves, a very simple answer. Can we go back to basics? Basics when we had no cars, no electricity, no telephone, no internet, no computer, no places of worship. Especially places of worship when we came here. 60, 70, 80 years ago, our fathers and grandparents came here as workers. And I remember a story of one of my colleagues, my friends, was from Yemen. He came in the 50s to work as a factory worker. And 7 and 8 of them used to be in one room. At that time, there was no place of worship. There was no community center. There was no madrasa. There was no schools. But they managed to change their homes, their houses, into madrasa, into community center, into school, into places of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is how, during this time, people managed to try to keep the deen, despite the fact they have less resources and less people in the country. If we can look at many stories happen to us, the stories of the children of Israel, when they were living in Egypt, tortured by the Pharaoh. The Pharaoh was worse than the Corona itself. So they turned their houses into a mosque or a place of worship at that time, because he was torturing them, who was actually killing the newly born babies, especially if they were actually male, and abusing the female amongst them. If we look at the beginning of Da'wah in Mecca for 13 years, Muslims with the Prophet ﷺ, the companions, had no mosque. Even they were denied to go to Al-Haram to pray by the Qurayshites. They either prayed at home or used to go and meet in Dar al-Arqam, the house of Arqam ibn Abi al-Arqam. There is nothing new in the history of Islam and in the history of humanity. If you look at the political detainee and the prisoner, the Guantanamo people, they managed to keep their religion in spite of the fact they were locked in. At that time, the way they believe, and they're still believing in the religion, kept them in safety regarding the religion itself. If we look at the Soviet Union, at the time of Stalin and Lenin and afterwards, and how much they treated the Muslims. They closed the mosque, demolished some of them, or changed them into warehouses and stables. Muslims decided the change their bedroom, their front room, their back, their back room into a mosque, into a madrasa, into a places of worship, because they want to hold tight to the robe of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when Soviet Union collapsed in the 80s or early 90s, they came out in strength, saving religion in their heart, so they were not failing. Even if we go back to Andalusia and see the history in Andalusia at that time, the 15th century, when the Portuguese and the French tortured the Muslims and killed them, Muslims still kept the mosque in their hearts and their houses to keep the religion, which came, and Spain and Portugal now have Islam there, because it is up to the individual. It is up to the individual. It's up to the individual to change his or her house into a mosque. Like Abu Bakr, when he was praying and reciting the Quran and was crying with a beautiful voice, you know, the kafir of Quraysh came to complain to the Prophet. You know why? Because their children and their wives were affected by the beautiful recitation of Abu Bakr at the time, at his house, at his backyard. So Abu Bakr and the others changed their houses into a mosque. Nobody can stop a Muslim from changing any piece of land into a mosque. Prophet said, "Ju'alat li al-ardu masjidan wa tahuran." Allah has made the land, the whole of earth, for me like a mosque, a pure land, a mosque for me. If we don't have a mosque to go to, our houses are mosques. So this lesson from the history will take us to the achievers when they were actually as political detainees in different kinds, parts of the world. Some of them completed HEPS, some of them got their degrees, university degrees, some of them wrote books, some of them wrote novels, and. So they never stopped, because they had a mission to accomplish, and they have a vision. When they get out of the prison, they will be able to help their community, to serve their community, and to save their community. These are some of the examples that I can take from the past to all of us. If I can take you to the difference between being a slave and being a worshiper, abd and abid. Allah created every human being, every being, to be a abd, to be a slave. Some of them believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and some of them did not believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The one who believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala became abid, became worship. That's why we want to change our places into places of worship. And this is entirely up to us. Up to us to move from the world of being abd, created by Allah as a slave, to be promoting myself to become a worshiper, an abid. So big difference between me as an abd and me as an abid. This is another thing which we need to look at. How do we connect to our legacy and community? There's so many means of communication nowadays. I remember in the good old days, we did not have all the facilities, but we managed to make it by walking, by talking, by meeting, by sitting together to think ahead for what we need to do. So now, with all the means of communication, nobody can stop you. Today, I had a conference call with Yemen and with Iraq. Yesterday, I had a conference call with, Canada. Last Thursday, I had a big lecture with about a few hundred people from different organizations in Baghdad and in Iraq and in Chad and in Turkey and in Kuwait. So there is no limit for the means of communication of today. We have to use it, not to be abused by it. We have to use the technology to connect. The most important thing that we can do nowadays to keep us busy at home and to decrease this agony of not being able to go to the mosque is connect, deliver, direct, guide, and save, and try to take some initiatives. This is how to connect. I take you to the story of Prophet Noah, alayhi salam. When he was actually giving da'wah to his people for 950 years, and few of them believed in him. You know what he was saying in the Quran? فَرَبِّ إِنِّي دَعَوْتُ قَوْمِي لَيْلًا وَنَهَارًا. He said, Allah, I have invited my people day and night. فَلَمْ يَزِدْهُمْ دُعَائِي إِلَّا فِرَارًا. The more I call upon them, I invite them, I try to be with them, they run away from me. وَإِنِّي كُلَّمَا دَعَوْتُهُمْ لِتَغْفِرَ لَهُمْ. And whenever I go to call upon them, to ask you, Allah, to forgive them, جَعَلُوا أَصَابِعُهُمْ فِي آذَنِهِمْ. They put the black their ears by their finger. وَاسْتَغْشَوْا ثِيَابَهُمْ. And they covered their head by their clothes. وَأَصَرُّوا وَاسْتَكْبَرُوا اسْتِكْبَارًا. And they were determined to turn their back to me and be arrogant with me. And he was inviting them for what? For Allah to forgive them. ثُمَّ إِنِّي دَعَوْتُهُمْ نَهَارًا. Then I call upon them during the day. I invited them publicly. جَهَارًا, not نَهَارًا. جَهَارًا. ثُمَّ إِنِّي دَعَوْتُهُمْ نَهَارًا. I went to talk to them and invite them and seek their privacy. And telling them what? Please ask Allah forgiveness. And if you ask Allah forgiveness, He is the forgiver. He will descend upon you from heaven all the blessing that He has. Give you money, give you wealth, give you the gardens and rivers and land. And then at the end of the day, at the end of the 950 years, why don't you have the respect for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He created you in stages? This is the story of Noah and the way he was communicating with his own people, day and night, publicly, privately, in secrecy. So nobody can stop us, brothers and sisters, listening today, from communicating, connecting, using the means of communication, the means of connection, but you have the drive. If we have the right iman and the depth of iman in our heart and the yaqeen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the clear intention, our houses will be a part of heaven and we'll make it mosques. And this is what actually we can talk about it actually later on. So if we talk about fasting alone or solitary fasting, as I was asking to talk about, it's very painful. Very painful that I don't see my mother, I don't see my brother, I don't see my sister, I don't see my son. I have got 5 sons and daughters in Birmingham. 4 of them are independent and 1 is with me. I cannot see the other 4. Neither them or their husband or their wives. Very painful. But I have to keep myself busy with doing 2 things. First of all, I look at what Allah has privileged me with. Health, knowledge, wealth, and safety in my society, and peace in my society. All this, I have to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for it, and bow down to Him. I say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, thank you for giving me all this. And on the other side, I have to look at the underprivileged in different parts of the world. To realize that an individual is dying every second from hunger. 36 million people every year. A child die every 5 seconds. 6 million children every year. I have to look at the condition of our brothers and sisters in China, the Uyghur, and how they've been tortured badly. More than 1 million people there, and we are silent about them. And we need to do something about them. And they have to go from there to Arakan Burma, to the Rohingya, for the last 5, 6, 7 years. And we are failing them because we become so busy with what we do to ourselves, for ourselves. Then I move west to Kashmir, Makbuza Kashmir, and Srinagar, and see how they've been surrounded by 1 million soldiers, torture, fear, and terror, and deprivation. Then I move from there to Yemen to see how the people are suffering for the last 5 years. A country, this population, about 15 to 20 million people are under the poverty level. And they have the war from their neighbors, the Muslims, whatever you call them, Muslims or whatever it is. Then they go to Syria. It is the ugliest scar on the face of humanity. The ugliest scar on the face of humanity, and all of us, including myself, we failed them. We failed the children, the women, the elderly, the displaced, the refugees, the detainees, the raped girls, and all this for 9 years. Have you ever in the history of man see something called the frozen children? People dying because they are frozen. They are not like chicken or beef or lamb that you keep them in deep freezers. They are a human being. Then you move from there to Gaza under siege for the last 7, 8 years, and we do little, because we are the do little people for them. Then we go from Gaza to Palestine as a whole, and to the rest of the world, to Eritrea, to Sudan, to Democratic Republic of Congo, which is not a Muslim country, but we have to care for it, to Sub-Saharan Africa. And when we look at the underprivileged in this area, we have to thank Allah for what He has given us, then we share with them what we have, then we care for them, then we work hard for them. Nobody can stop you from doing any voluntary activity from home. From home, nobody can stop us from doing, sending any guiding messages from home. We should not use an excuse of being locked down or locked in our houses. We cannot do anything. We can do a lot. We can reflect during the time that we are at home, thinking about our life, thinking about our failures, thinking about our achievement, and thinking about how can we do something for humanity. And we saw this gentleman, a 99-year-old veteran, who walked the 100 meters at the age of 99. I don't know how much people donated for the coronavirus in respect of such an individual. Such an individual inspiring us, driving us, guiding us, and helping us to change our houses into mosques. And the mosque is not only a place of the ritual worship, it's a place where we can change our hearts, our mind, and our soul, and build our character and take it from mosque to the community. We don't go to the mosque in Ramadan only to earn blessings and to count the blessings. No, we go to the mosque to charge our hearts. We receive Ramadan to build our morale and to charge our hearts for the whole year. The worship in Islam is not the ritual one, the fasting, the prayer, the hajj, and the zakat. No, it is how, it's this, as well as how to help and to save. When the Prophet, not Prophet, when Ibn Abbas entered the mosque in Medina and found somebody making i'tikaf in the house of the Prophet and the mosque of the Prophet, he told him that the one who is going out to help and to save and to guide his community is far more better than the one who is making i'tikaf in my mosque. As the Prophet said, for a month or 2 months or 3 months. This is how can we change our mosques, our houses into mosques, and how can we recharge our hearts by connection, by working, by volunteering with others, and by reviewing our life and see how much we achieve and how much we fail and what to go for. We can make grouping on the social media and others that in different countries, this Zooming become like a plethora of them. And most of them, subhanAllah, in the poor countries, in the in places where technology is not as good as in UK or Europe or America. So we should not take the closures of mosques as a no go for us. We'll take the challenge and we'll overcome it by connecting, by communicating, by doing something like the seminar of today. I don't know how many people are watching, but this is a way forward to keep delivering da'wah regardless of the challenges that we are facing. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you. JazakAllah khair. Assalamu alaikum.